there is open up. Let me talk for a minute. Good morning. My name is Eunice Reiser, and I will be your moderator for this morning. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan, operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord or God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many, but we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edge of the chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on a shape and form and right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plain as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plain? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures compared to religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas, and we will have a scripture lesson, Ephesians, the 3rd chapter by LaShawn Love, and we will have a selection of music.
Good morning, class. Okay. One more time. Good morning, class. It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for having us in the place of the highest learning. Our first aim is to help us to find you. This is very important. We have to find you, and you are everywhere in the universe, and the stellar universe is so big that you are everywhere. and we are aware of that in this school. Keep teaching us all the mysteries, all the things we don't know, and open you our mind, open our brain for the understanding is what we need. Mm-hmm. Understanding is very important. I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Yeah. Hi, good morning, class.
Good morning.
This morning I'll be reading Ephesians, the third chapter, out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by A.B. Traina of the Scripture Research Association. Ephesians chapter 3. For this cause I, Saul, the prisoner of Yahshua the Messiah, for you of the nations. If ye have heard of the ministry of the peace of Yahweh, which is given to me, to you ward, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote before in a few words, whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of the Messiah, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, and it is now revealed unto his holy, until his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in the Messiah by the glad tidings, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of Yahweh given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the nations the unsearchable riches of the Messiah, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages hath been hid in Yahweh, who created all things by Yahshua the Messiah, to the intent that now through the administrating powers in heavenly places might be known by the assembly the manifold wisdom of Yahweh, according to the eternal purpose which he proposed in Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. Wherefore I desire that ye faint not at my tribulations of for you, which is in glory. For this cause I bow my knee unto the Father of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that the Messiah may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of the Messiah, which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of Yahweh. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the assembly by the Messiah, Yahshua, throughout all generations and all ages. We all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas and LaShawn Love. And this morning, our speaker will be our dean, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
How's everybody?
Good.
Good to be here once again. Because of Yahweh's grace and mercy that he allowed us to come, at least gather together in person, on Zoom, or on YouTube, whichever way we can get it, in order to, as the prayer said, to help us learn about Yahweh in truth, in honesty, and in the reality of who and what that spirit is. It being Sunday, Memorial Day weekend, a time to reflect upon those, as they say, are of the involved in the military aspect, in order to take care of or to protect and to serve, as it were, this great nation here in America. And being mindful and thinking about that, I think that every nation has a sense of reverence to their kingdom. You know, England has theirs. Different parties that have lands, they have their protectors, as it were, as though the United States government, with all its mighty powers of Air Force, Army, Navy, and the Marines, are set up in order to protect this nation, essentially, or our being able to habitate here. That's a witness that Yahweh's put in place, you see, a witness for the whole world to have some part of being associated with something, whereby they feel a part of something. They call it a national anthem, you follow? And so every nation has a sense of some reverence. You know, Nebuchadnezzar had his, whereby they sang an anthem to Nebuchadnezzar. Grab me Daniel 2, and I guess we can start at 1, but we're going to skip down in order to show that this holiday, if you would, or assembly of giving allegiance to something, for people having done something, as though that is what protects us. You know what I'm saying? That the servicemen and women that endure and go away and are separate from our their families and whatnot, that's a sense of serving. But yet, being in this school and taking what the scriptures say, and believing in what those scriptures say and what they are pointing out to, which is Yahshua the Messiah, right? Mm-hmm. And we become to know and understand that he is our Savior. You follow? Right. He was slain before the foundation of the world, whereby in all men, in all generations, in all nationalities are to come and then ultimately look to Yahshua. Mm-hmm. You follow? Now, I don't have a problem with the holidays, barbecue and hamburgers and eating and being able to get away from work and have a day off and relax and rest. Not a problem. But yet, we are to keep in our minds, as the scripture expressed, that it's unto Yahshua that all things are given for unto us. And it's that understanding is that's what's going to eventually save our soul. Because as we know that the world, although our nation is protected by servicemen and whatnot, ultimately that's not the Savior. And that's not the thing that's going to keep us right from harm's way. Right. You follow? And so we want to, again, go into this teaching and this study with an understanding that Biden or the National Congress or anything mankind wants to put together as far as a law or some kind of ordinance whereby we're going to be a better, safer nation is unlikely to happen, put it that way. And so we don't want to get into that druther as though we're just here on this land and nowhere else to go, whereby Yahweh don't work by that. He's not saving just America, is what I'm saying, as well.
Right.
You follow? This is not his intention for America to be great, as Trump often likes to put it. You follow? And it doesn't matter to me, anyways, which party you're privy to here, as though that's something of importance. As you die, as we all been ascribed to die, but right, to die of what is the question. And that's where a lot of people have yet to come into the full reality, as as John expressed, having come into a full understanding of the revelation of Yahshua Messiah. And to say that you can't, or we can't, is preposterous, because Dr. Kinley received the divine vision and revelation, understanding that he did receive it all at once. You follow? That's what's the caveat of the statement, whereby he's received it all at once, and we're receiving it piecemeal. And piecemeal, all I mean is that we've come into this teaching knowing Lord God and Jesus Christ for many, many people, ultimately. You follow? And when you didn't know anything about Yahweh, one didn't know anything about Elohim, and no one know anything about Yahshua Messiah. Follow? Mm-hmm. That peace is a peace. Right. And even though you know about Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, don't mean you know the whole story. You follow? Because there are many people that know of the name of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. Mind you, in 1930, you have the Sacred Name Movement. They knew, and that's the book she just read off, is your scripture reading, of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And they still don't know the mystery of Yahweh.
Right.
And that's a piece of understanding the whole reality of what Yahweh's purpose is. Now, A.B. Traynor, in that Bible, he was given a vision about this name of Yahweh, this title of Elohim, and this name of Yahshua the Messiah. And until this day, people got this name spelt wrong, essentially. They're striving. They got Yeshua oftentimes, Y-E-S-H-U-A. Right. Now, as the moderator said, you get a more clear understanding about this name, Yahshua, if you read your Holy Name Bible. Now, we're not going to delve into the name so much at this particular time, but let it be known that it is Yahshua. And we understand that he came in his Father's name. And whereby we can have Yahweh made available, whereby we can see the significance of this Yah,
right,
which is the precursor to this Shua, which is salvation, and that how he came in his Father's name, which is Yahweh. That Yah being masculine and that way being feminine. You follow? Now, there's a lot to just that statement right there. And that's a piece of one's understanding. Mm-hmm. You follow? And so thinking that you're getting it piecemeal is not a bad thing. We're grateful for every jot and little tittle that we're able to receive in order to point back or point us to, as the prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas stated, is to help us know something about Yahweh. You follow? Mm-hmm. And we're coming to know about Yahweh through his son, Yahshua the Messiah. You see? And when we say Yah to help you know and find Yahweh, our Elohim, it's not just Yahweh Elohim, because Yahweh Elohim is depicted as this incorporeal being here. You follow? That's one state and condition by which Yahweh transformed and transmuted himself into being. You follow? This is Yahweh in an incorporeal state, right, meaning not fleshly. Right. Later on, this word, or the Son, or Yahshua, came down into a fleshly body known as Yahshua the Messiah at an appointed time. But we often have to remember and not never forget that this incorporeal form been here since the beginning of time. Therefore, he took up residence inside of Adam on the sixth day when he breathed into him the breath of life. Because as I understood in John 1 and 4, that he, Yahweh Elohim, or the Son, is the light that lighteth every man.
That's right.
You follow? Therefore, that first man, Adam, had the light in him, and he was Elohim as well on the ground. You see, and then ultimately, if we understand how this migratory pattern works, which we ought to understand and which we do teach in day in and day out, is that we have to understand that Yahshua was down here with Moses. You follow? Before, some 1,400 years before, this one Yahshua, the Messiah of Nazareth, came into being. So understand that this word, John 1 and 1, before the creation was ever created, existed in the form of spirit.
Right.
And this spirit entered into the hearts and minds of Adam and Eve. You follow? Eve, not knowing and being deceived of exactly who and what she was at an appointed time, it was because of the purpose of Yahweh, mm-hmm, that she was beguiled by that serpent. You follow? As we have depicted here on the elementary chart on this first plate, because this is going to be the beginning of a transgression. The transgression for mankind today in order to see what was set up by Yahshua, the Messiah. Because in Yahweh made or transformed into himself, it's been expressed that Yahweh went out of the creating business.
Right.
You follow? And he left the whole business to his sons. You remember Sanford and Sons, right?
Right.
Lamont, he was left the business,
yeah,
essentially, to run the junkyard.
Yeah.
So you have Yahshua having taken on his father's business, because remember, everything was set up in the realm of eternity.
Mm-hmm.
So Yahweh, knowing he's not nothing you're going to tell Yahweh about, he needs to fix this. He needs to fix mass shootings. He needs to fix this, as though he's not associated with it in no kind of way. It's impossible. He set up all things. We read last class in Deuteronomy that I kill and I make alive. You can't fix that unless you don't believe it. And so all we're doing by piecemeal, a little here and a little there. So say Isaiah, line upon line, precept upon precept.
Right.
We're getting it by piece.
Right.
You follow? And that's all right. As we begin to formulate, as not we, but as Yahshua, the Messiah, the Holy Spirit, begins to formulate this story or this gospel or this truth within your earring, your hearing, in your consciousness, to take root as he did Saul, because we know Saul, he persecuted the assembly of Yahshua the Messiah. The persecution of assembly of Yahshua the Messiah. You see, he was down here with Stephen, and they who stoned him laid their cloaks at his feet. Saul, I'm speaking of. And Saul, you can read it there in the 9th chapter of Acts, he goes about to tell you his conversion, as it were, psychologically and spiritually so.
Mm-hmm.
It's that same psychologically and spiritually so that we're going to go through that same understanding and revelation of how these charts or how these events in time were really structured in order to bring one from up out of Egypt or darkness and into the light, typified by Canaan's land or the most holy place. You follow? And now, knowing that this is not a physical location,
right,
because there's a Jerusalem from above, and that's where we're going to take our habitation at, whereby we can have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit while on earth.
Mm-hmm.
You follow?
That's right.
And the only thing after that to do is to teach all men everywhere the purpose and mission of one Yahshua the Messiah. Because as Yahshua said there in Matthew, they take my yoke upon me and learn of me.
Right.
You follow? For his burden is light.
Right.
You follow? His yoke is not egregious.
Yep.
You see, he's humble and kind. But how? And then you look out around the world now with our understanding, it looks atrocious. It looks very unsettling oftentimes. But having an understanding or the faith, which Saul just said in the scripture reading, having that faith be in you, established, and knowing the doctrine or the gospel of Yahshua Messiah, set you, make you free. That's what we're purporting to do.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So let's read a little bit here at Daniel and see if we can catch the nation. I want to really just get to where he makes them want them to bow down to the song. But start at one and maybe I'll be able to find it.
Okay. Daniel 2. And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams wherewith his spirit was troubled and his sleep break from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians and astrologers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans for to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said unto them, I have dreamed a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syria, O king, live forever. Mm-hmm. Tell thy servant the dream, and we will show the interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. If ye will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation thereof, ye shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made a dungeon hill.
Now that's a Gentile speaking to his clan, his folks. And then we have here, this is plate 26 on a 40-plate chart that Dr. Kinley has put together. And he sanctioned this plate as a history plate. You follow? Mm-hmm. Plate 26, where we have a stone here, okay? Mm-hmm. We have Babylon. We have the Medes and Persia. We have Grecia. We have Papal and Papal Rome. Here's the feet. You follow?
Mm-hmm.
And then now down here in the bed, who is this?
Nebuchadnezzar.
This is Nebuchadnezzar down here having this vision that she just expressed here in Daniel. You follow? Mm-hmm. And he's in a dead-like state, going back to here little, there little, to understand this history.
Right.
You follow? Because there's no one new here today. We can express it like this. Grab me Isaiah 28:9-10. Grab me Isaiah 8:20. I'll need 8:20 first. And I want to 8:20.
Okay.
Now, I'll preface it like this. Having been in this class for some time and hearing this gospel, we want to understand what about it. And what we have to understand is that there are scriptures, right? And then there are other books. Some call it the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The Acts of the Apostles, written by Luke, or ascribed to Luke for having written. And then you have certain letters of Paul or Saul, and then various other of the Apostles. Now, understanding that Bible you have is simply Bible, meaning a compilation of books or of writings. That's what the Bible is. You see, Bible in and of itself is not holy. It's just a book that has other writings in it. Now, the writings it has, I'm going to need John 5:39, please. Now, the Bible has many other writings, and it's broken up in two parts. One, the Old Testament, and one, the New Testament. You follow? Now, what we want to understand is, why isn't the whole Bible just called Scripture? And in its simplicity, anything that's written is scripture. Anything handwritten is called scripture. Newspaper is a scripture. A magazine or periodical is scripture. That's what scripture means when you write it. But we want to understand which scriptures and what they're for, so that when we go into this dream of Nebuchadnezzar, which is, hey, again, it's a vision. And like Nebuchadnezzar just said, he had the dream, but he can't remember it.
Right.
But it moved them to kill people if they can't recall what his dream is, mm-hmm. and what it meant. That's a problem.
Yeah.
You follow? I had a dream the other night, and man, it took me forever to try to remember not to let it go, because I was enjoying the dream. But it eventually evaded me according to my consciousness,
right.
And I had to wake up. And you know, I don't write nothing down, but I kept rehearsing what was it, so they would pick up the continuity. I never could find it again. But I let that be unto Yahweh, mm-hmm. to bring it back to my remembrance. Mm-hmm. Now, if that's the case in our lives, and it happens to every one of us periodically,
right.
Nebuchadnezzar's having it. He's writing about it, and he's the king. And he's saying, hey, I need to know what that dream was. And what did it mean?
Mm-hmm.
And if you can't tell me what it was, off with your heads. You follow? Now, that's a bad situation to be in, to even be one of his boys, right? And so that's a principle that we want to keep in mind when we're talking about these scriptures and what they're really meaning, to get the continuity, you know, The Messiah tells Nicodemus, if I tell you physical things and you don't believe them, how am I going to tell you spiritually things? Right. Hey, having a vision is a spiritual revelation. And just jumping right into Daniel and think you're going to pertain and perceive all of what Daniel's Nebuchadnezzar's dream is all about, it's a hard place to be put in that understanding. Because I started off by saying, hey, you have a death. Right. Because Nebuchadnezzar is dead in his sleep.
Right.
That's a form of death. Yeah. Sleep is a cousin of death. You see, that's a principle. Now you have a principle of being immersed consciously in your dream. That's a state and condition. That's a place you went to and been immersed into, right? And so that has to be understood and accepted. And then there's going to be a resurrection out of that once the dream comes to light. And when Nicodemus finally gets the answer to what that dream is about. Right. By way of one Daniel. Now, Daniel's a prophet.
Right.
Many people call Daniel a major prophet. No, let that be understood clearly that there's not a major and there's not minor prophets. Because we understand that Peter, 1 Peter talks about all that the prophets have written were by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So you don't have one better prophet or one lesser prophet. They're all zero according to Yahweh's purpose. It was just that Yahweh or that Holy Spirit wrote in them the things that they needed to write for his purpose.
Right.
So you're not looking at Daniel or Nahum. Or those who might not have written quite as much, pertaining to our logical thinking, they wrote. Well, Isaiah wrote a lot. He must have known a lot.
Yeah.
Isaiah didn't know nothing.
Yeah.
Daniel, Job, Jeremiah didn't know nothing, as far as comprehending the purpose of Yahweh. You follow? Mm-hmm. So these are the things we have to take hold and may be new to some of our ears by thinking they didn't know or they didn't understand. No man knew the purpose of Yahweh until Yahweh made it clear unto them at an appointed time. And we'll catch that up here in a moment. Now, let's go ahead and read John 5 and 39. Because this is the Messiah, or everyone's beloved Jesus, as it were, beginning to talk to the scribes. Read.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Go up a scripture above that, please. Mm. To who he's talking to.
But I have greater witness than that of John.
Mm-hmm.
For the works which the Father has given me to finish, the same works I do.
Mm-hmm.
And they bear witness of me that mm-hmm. the Father has sent me.
Mm-hmm.
And the Father himself, which has sent me, has borne witness of me.
Okay.
Ye have neither heard his voice at any time,
now,
nor seen his shape.
Now the Messiah is talking to a particular specific group of people called the scribes and the Pharisees of the Jews at this particular time. Keep reading.
And ye have not his word abiding in you. For whom he had sent him, ye believe not.
Mm-hmm.
Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now this is a question to most people. And this is why we want to make clear what that Bible and how that Bible's set up. The Messiah is here telling them at that particular time, during the fourth dispensation, that they searched the scriptures. They did not have a Bible. They didn't have a Holy Bible. They didn't have a King James Bible or nothing of the like. So therefore, one has to be able to express to me what scriptures is Yahshua the Messiah referring to.
Right.
That's just a fair, clear statement.
Right.
They have scriptures, not a problem. But which ones did they have? That's what we want to make clear. And that's what we want to know. And before we go off any further, finish up right there.
And they are they which testify of me.
Now they, those scriptures that they had in the fourth dispensation, in the third age, according to time, as we've learned how times come to be, mm-hmm. a piece, and this is a little of that piece.
That's right.
Whereby we understand where we're at in that conversation in that book called the so-called New Testament.
Right.
You follow?
Right.
And we're looking at Yahshua Messiah, letting them know that, hey, the scriptures, which are about him. So therefore, all of what they had was comprised of the law and next 34 books of the prophets, or the testimony, as it would, from Joshua to Malachi. They had them. They had them written all over their bodies, inscribed in the little thing on their head.
Yeah.
The Teflon, where they had scrolls of what the prophets and what the law was all about, or the Pentateuch, where they had that, and that's what they were trying to study, thinking it was going to bring them some kind of salvation. That's why we're expressed. You can read that Bible from here to eternity, and it's not going to do you a bit of good if you're not understanding how it's put together and how it's structured. So now you got to have Isaiah 8 and 20, please.
To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Now, it's not no light in them. Who's them? That's Isaiah writing. Let's find out who's them is right quick. Keep reading on down.
And they shall pass through it, hard pressed and hungry.
Mm-hmm.
And it shall come to pass that when they shall be hungry, they will become angry and curse their king and their deities and look upward for help.
Now, that's what a lot of people expressing, reading the Bible and not making hide nor hair of it is what they do. Because a lot of people think God is up there in the sky. That's why Isaiah let them know they're going to be hard-pressed and hungry, wanting some words, wanting some understanding,
right,
wanting some light. That's what that light in that verse is expressing, of the law and the prophets, in order to bring one some light or an understanding about what the Bible's and what the Bible is, and how it really tells you so, but according to Yahweh's purpose.
Right.
And this is why we got to get certain concepts out of our head about the Bible before we start getting into dreams of Nebuchadnezzar, dreams of Ezekiel and Daniel, and the visions of Moses, and on and on and on, in order to see a foundation of how we're here expressing the various things out of that Bible according to a timeline and according to a pattern and according to a purpose. Follow me? Mm-hmm. So now, according to the law and the prophets, the first five books being comprised of Moses, and the next subsequent 34 books, as I've already said, the testimony. That comprises the law and the prophets about Yahshua. Now, be mindful, Yahshua is just not that physical person talking to the scribes and Pharisees when he told them that. Yahshua, the Messiah, you see here is a name. This name is associated with the Holy Spirit.
Right.
You follow? And we talked about Thursday how the most denominations look at the Holy Spirit as a standalone entity. Then they look at the Son, which they ascribed as Jesus Christ, and then they have his dad up there in the sky as the Father or the Lord in the sky on a throne. Mm-hmm. That's a concept in a man's imagination.
Yes, sir.
Now they know that their Father or their Lord is doing or telling his Son something, or going to send his Son back to fix this world.
Yeah.
You follow? And they're trying to ascribe to this Holy Spirit, just zooming around and in and out of places and having evil spirits and things of that nature, right? That's the concept that we're trying to take and reimagine according to a pattern and a systematic way or a purpose that Yahweh has instructed. The Old Testament are the scriptures that are about, one, the Holy Spirit. You follow? By the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And so as we begin to understand that Yahshua the Messiah is back here with Daniel. He's not left off anywhere. The principle of what we're going to read here in Daniel about Nebuchadnezzar's dream is by way of the Holy Spirit. Now, we have Nebuchadnezzar not knowing what his dream was about, because Yahweh put him in a deep sleep, put him in a vision, and made him see something. He made him see this chart. We call it Daniel's chart. Now, what this Daniel's chart essentially is proving the existence and destruction of Satan and his angels through the dispensations and ages. You follow? That's the history of mankind. I was just on the ages and dispensations chart. That's a lot of words and numbers associated and lines associated with that chart. That's a history chart of the world, right? Now we fast forward to this chart. We have the same thing without a whole lot of words and lines. It's more imagery, if you would. And what we're having is the degeneration in the first Adam. You follow? Meaning this is a downward plate. You follow? This is the first plate that I had shown over to you on the elementary chart earlier. This downward operation shows the fall of man and the separation, if you would, from Elohim. Because I said that Yahweh Elohim, when I was on that chart, before the world was created, before man was created, he was everything. And he got into the man Adam and Eve. Because, hey, we know that Eve came from out of Adam. And Adam came from out of Mother Earth, out of the dust of the ground. Yep. Then Eve's coming out of the body of the rib and womb of Adam. You follow? Taking on that pattern, you right. See? And it's a principle thing. We know ain't nobody ever come up out of the earth in this period, day and age, right. And was formed as a body.
Right.
But we're looking at principles. We know ain't no man have heard a snake speak neither. You follow? So we have to look at the principles of what we're going to be using in order to describe the imagery and the purpose of the words that we hear in that book. And so by we having seen that this Luciferic spirit, or as we say, Satan and his demons, or angels, beguiled Eve. We all know about that fruit that she took and then gave it to the man Adam. And then express why he knows so many questions as to why would he do that. And you know, we're in this bad situation because of Adam, our mother and father, because they did that to us. And they wasn't thinking, and she got duped. Or whatever number of ideas or opinions and theories or concepts one may have. You see, that's what we're trying to dispel.
Right.
That's what God says confused now. That's what has us not knowing or understanding Yahweh. Or, as the prayer said, to help you find and know. This is part of helping you find and know that no snake spoke, and there was no angel outside of her, and that it was within Eve for a purpose.
That's right.
And it's this purpose by which we're trying to elaborate and to share with people around the world, because this is very elementary, and it's very known throughout the world. And understanding that when Adam partook of that fruit, they transgressed, or they fell out of heaven, you follow? Or Eden, as it were, which is a type of heaven. Now, in that falling or separation from Eden, that's a transgression of a state of thinking or of consciousness that they lost. And it's this degeneration of the first man, Adam, is what has to be restored in each and every one of us. By way of the foolishness of preaching the gospel. You follow? And it's through this foolishness, because it's the same foolishness Eve partook of. You follow? And so we're going to do it the same way, but in reverse. She listened to, as the scripture said, you read the fourth chapter of Ephesians, it's going to talk about other doctrines, being deceived of the other doctrines. And we don't want that to happen. Grab that. Ephesians, please. Ephesians 4. I think is apropos to bring this up. Because, you know, people are talking about Daniel and the visions and things as though they know what they're talking about according to visions. And in Daniel 4, I went down to Ephesians. Doctrines of man. Maybe not.
17.
You see it there?
live, not as the heathens live.
Yep, yep, yep. I want something around there. Okay. 4:14. So do a 4. Yeah, I just started 4:14 is fine.
Okay.
Yep. Now follow me. That Eve was beguiled by words. You follow? Words of the satanic spirit or satanic entity that she conjured up based off the purpose now. You follow? That Yahweh is setting this up for mankind to see who and what he is as the prayers to start off the day. And this is what we want to be able to withstand against once we have an understanding about the true gospel and the true light that lighteth every man. And now we have this event that started off everything, if you would. You follow? As far as according to a time principle. Because while they were in Eden here, time hadn't started.
Right.
Because all the fruits in the fruit or the fruition was already there. The sun wasn't rising and setting, as it were. They were in a state of Eden or eternity. You follow? And you don't have anything until they eat. And that's when time began to start. Until that time, they were at peace, in harmony. They were not ashamed of their consciousness of what they were doing. But because of time, because of Yahweh's purpose, he caused this event to transpire.
Right.
He caused them to be expelled from out of that state of eternity.
Mm-hmm.
And we see this sun here, which is a type of the S-U-N, coming down and being hidden into darkness. It is this principle by which both Adam and Eve went about having their situation established on earth, if you would. They're coming down out of this Edenic state of thinking and into a work-life state for Adam, or a offspring state for Eve,
right,
that they're going to have to be saved by childbearing. You follow? So these are all imageries of a thoughts of how we are going to be coming out of a state of ignorance or of darkness, having lost our first estate, if you would. Just as we come out or down from our father's loins, from our his consciousness, because there's a spermatic fluid that comes down and centers into the scrotum until an appropriate time it's released. You follow? That's the same principle that's coming down.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking at spiritual things.
Right.
And when it's coming down, we're stuck in this condition of time through history. And we can read all about the historicity of what's transpiring through this seed that's been lost, if you would. And when we're getting here to the end and understand what this whole purpose was about, this is what we don't want to happen to us. Mm. Read.
That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine.
Every wind of doctrine, everyone's denominations, everyone say, come here, listen to this. Come here, listen to this guy. Where is he at? You don't want to listen to all of that history about a false doctrine or winds of doctrine that you're lost in. Mm-hmm. Keep reading, please.
By the sleight of men and cunning craftiness.
See, that's what they do. They craft together a denomination, piece it together in order to basically take your money,
mm-hmm,
or to give them some honor,
mm-hmm,
or give them some glory based off of the things you've heard from out of a Bible that's utter foolishness, reading it straight through without any support. Keep reading, please.
Whereby they lie in wait to deceive.
This is what Lucifer was doing. So you have it better depicted on this chart when you have Lucifer. Oh, where is it at, man? This one.
Yeah.
Lying in wait.
Yeah.
Reread what you just read right quick, please.
That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine,
uh-huh,
by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive.
You see here, Adam and Eve, they were one in the garden, right? Made them one twine. But see, this lying in wait, Lucifer lying in wait, because when they're together, they was fine. But when you have them separate, and you have Eve coming to that tree, you have this Luciferic spirit talking to Eve within her consciousness, Adam off yonder, looking at what she's doing alone and by herself, invisible, thinking, no, she wouldn't dare. But lo and behold, she did dare. And she did believe that thought. And these are these doctrines that we hear now that are all about this Bible is not making any sense, and we're being tossed to and fro. Keep reading, please.
But being truthful in love, ye may grow up into him in all things.
Oh, we're going to grow up, not be little children, not act feeble-minded. Read.
Which is the head, even the Messiah.
Mm-hmm, which is the head, the Messiah. Read.
From whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted, by which every joint supplieth.
Now this is what we're going to become, is that whole body of Yahshua the Messiah, which is spirit. You follow? Now back to Isaiah. So you got winds of doctrine, denominations, tossing you, that potentially can toss you to and fro. Mm-hmm. Now you have Isaiah back here in 8:22 reading.
You want
Isaiah
8:20?
Yeah. 8:22. Because you're already 8:22.
Okay. And they shall look unto the earth, mm-hmm, and behold trouble and darkness.
See that,
of anger.
That earth is where Adam and Eve was placed on. And there was nothing but darkness. But it wasn't dark like dark outside. It was darkness from not being separated from Elohim, or from the Holy Spirit of knowledge of good and evil. That's what they were lost from. Mm-hmm. And they were in darkness to that. Whereby he had to work by the sweat of her brow. And she was supposed to be saved in childbearing. But we have to understand what's working. What part of our consciousness is working. And what's part of our woman or our child is working, essentially. Mm-hmm. Keep reading there.
Mm-hmm. And they shall be driven to darkness.
Mm-hmm.
Go to 9.
Mm-hmm.
There is no fatigue to him that oppresseth her.
Mm-hmm.
When at first he lighted afflicted that land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali.
That's good enough. Now, so we have a state and condition that if you don't have an understanding according to the law and the prophets, that you'll be in darkness. And what we're expressing is, as I just said, this degeneration from the first man, Adam, you have this fall. And then what you have is this Luciferic caricature of a serpent that's going to go to and fro without the land. This is where you have that raven in with Noah.
Right.
That's where you have that satanic spirit going to and fro, conquering or devouring anybody who's going to believe a false report or a lie. And consuming them and taking over them in an imagination or a concept that's not going to do your soul any good. Whereby when we understand what the truth is, it will make you free. Because you're not just being set free, as some denominations would like you to believe. You got to be made to understand the doctrine. Grab me Isaiah 28:9-10. Please.
Whom shall he teach knowledge?
Whom shall he teach knowledge? Read.
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
Make. Not set free just because they want to be and do whatever their spirit telling them to do. Because a lot of people are spiritual these days. And they don't really regale religion so much, or that Bible anymore so much. But they'll say, hey, it's the spirit that I move by and I'm going to listen to that is I'm just set free. You ain't been made to do anything. But the scripture says that whom shall he teach knowledge,
right,
and whom shall he make to what?
To understand doctrine.
To understand doctrine. The prayer, I think, stated, Doc said, let him make us understand these charts and the scriptures that are about you, Yahweh, mm-hmm, so that we can reside in peace and harmony within ourselves. Because you're never going to make the outside world peace and harmony. Without a doubt. Wasn't set up to be under peace and harmony as the Jehovah's Witnesses would have you to believe, as though you're going to go lie out there with the lions and kick back with the sheep and be on some grassy knoll, you know, eating tomatoes all day. It's not going to work like that. It was never set up for that. So let's keep reading.
Them that are weaned from the milk,
mm-hmm,
and drawn from the breast.
What does that mean? What are he talking about there? How are he going to be weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. Because we all had did that in some fashion or another with our mothers. Mm-hmm. Because the mothers had two breasts.
Right.
And they're being weaned on both ones according to food and nourishment as they're typically set up for.
Mm-hmm.
Follow? But we understand and we come to know that this gospel is set up on plates. Becca would tell you in 2 and 2 that we read and understand and eat off of plates. And what we have here is an elementary chart. And Dr. Kenny put this together in a form of plates, threefold, if you would. You have a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. And you have this same feature depicted in each one of the events and time throughout history. You follow? According to his story, that we can see a death, a burial, and a resurrection. You follow me? Or we can see a blood, a water, and a spirit, and 40, and ascension. And I'm saying it these ways because this is what Isaiah is talking about here in 28, 9, and 10. Read.
For precept must be upon precept.
Precept is a principle that doesn't change and it doesn't waver just with your opinion or with your imagination.
Right.
It's consistent. If I have this stick, and which way is it going to go? It's going to go down.
Right.
That's a principle. That's a precept. That's gravity, if you would. You follow? For you scientists out there, it's not going to float and levitate. You follow? It don't change. When I drop it, it's going to continuously to fall to the ground. I can rely on that. And this is what we have these charts here. And what we're looking at is principles throughout all the events. The manifestation will change,
right,
but the principle will remain the same. The precept will remain the same throughout all of these events, throughout time, even until this day. These principles remain true. And it's these principles which is the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit ain't changing his mind.
Okay.
The Holy Spirit set it up in the realm of eternity, and he came out in order to finish the course of work. The Messiah said he come to do what his father is spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua, the Messiah, is spirit. He died, he was buried, and he resurrected. Just as I just said, there's a death, there's a burial, and there's a resurrection. And when the Yahshua Messiah resurrected on that third day, and he resurrected a quickening spirit, and it's that spirit is what we're seeking to demonstrate that spirit throughout the course of time of history. So through the law and the prophets, in order to bring you up to snuff of where we're at in the day and time. So we're not beguiled, we're not being tossed as little children from every wind of doctrine, not coming up with our own imagination, concept, opinion, and theory.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to do that anymore.
Oh, yeah.
We want to get in line with our mother and father, which is Yahweh alone. You follow?
Right.
And we have it depicted here because he died. After you get through the history, and you get where we're at the particular time when Yahshua Messiah went out here in Golgotha in order to die like an outcast dog, which was by purpose. Because he even told his boys, he said, I got to go away. If I don't go away, the Holy Spirit or Comforter won't come if I don't go away. The Comforter has to come, realizing he's the Comforter.
Right.
But in this state and condition in the physical body, he could only do so much.
Right.
And the only reason he came to do is to finish his father's work, which was to fulfill all that he set up. That's what I'm saying, that from Adam all the way down, when it transgressed, it was by purpose. And he's setting it up through Babylon, setting up through the Medes and Persians, setting up through Grecia, setting up through Rome and Babylon. All the events that we hear, and even Nebuchadnezzar, when we get to him, he set all of that up in order for us to see how he was fulfilling. Not instituting. He instituted from the very beginning, according to precepts and precepts and principles that we now can take hold and take to the bank. Although physically may not want to go always to the bank. That's another story. But typically, you want to take your money to the bank so you have some surety. You follow? And this is the gospel that we're preaching. And there only can be but one. You follow? Because as Saul said, he received a vision. and he received the gospel. Just like we all have received the gospel through the gospel, through the preaching of the gospel. And we're saying here that we just read was set up before the time began. And when we see that it was for a purpose that Yahshua came in order to fulfill all of from 4,000 years from Adam all the way to Yahshua the Messiah, was that Romans 10, 8, from Romans, from Moses until you know what I want? He came in to fulfill. I messed up. I think Romans 8. Grab me, I think Romans 5 and 14. I think 5 and 14 or do it too. Yeah, exactly. 5 and 14. Now follow me. I'm saying when the Yahshua Messiah came in and was to die and do this on purpose and not instituting anything but fulfilling. This is what he's fulfilling because I made the statement. He's fulfilled some 4,000 years. You follow? And what we're saying here from Adam, which is the degeneration in the first Adam and the regeneration of the second Adam. You follow? Is what we want to get to and understand. Whereby the purpose of Yahshua, read now.
Can I do 12?
Yes, you may.
Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world.
This is Adam. It's entering in, read.
And death by sin. Mm-hmm. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
All of them, from this time of Adam, all the way through Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, Medes, Persians, Tower of Babel, Nimrod, Grisha, you follow me? All of these dynasties, world dynasties, not just a little spot down in Africa that just ruled territory in the Dominican Republic or wherever they were at, South Africa. They weren't world dynasties. We're talking about world dynasties whereby the whole world had to come into them, whichever it was, in order to get anything and being able to bow down to the then known ruler. As we'll read here with Nebuchadnezzar in a moment. But keep reading.
For until the law, sin was in the world.
Until the law, the sin has been in the world. Read.
But sin is not imputed where there is no law.
It's been sin in the world, but until it was imputed by Moses instituting that law unto the Gentiles. We're looking at back here, under the law, was for a purpose. That Yahweh's instituting. He said that the scriptures you read are about him.
Right.
You follow? Not about these individual dynasties neither. That's why I said in the very beginning, you can have Veterans Day all you want and Memorial Day all you want, but there's a greater empire that's having given us salvation from all of that been created. You follow? That supersedes any American greatest force, as you want to call it. They have nothing compared to the salvation of Yahshua Messiah unto your soul after this creation. You follow? So, although I'm thankful, don't get me twisted, I was in the Marine Corps too, ooh-rah, I get it. But what's on my mind about it is definitely not protecting you. I'm just letting it be so.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'd have been a 30-year, 40-year veteran just saying ooh-rah until this day and following after some known president until this day, if I really truly believed and loved all that I loved about America. I'm just being honest. And so now when we understand what I see of this degeneration and this regeneration, by whom? Read.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses.
Oh, from Adam. That death. To and past Moses, it reigned. Because you got the prophet John the Baptist preaching or praying to at the River Jordan in order to behold the Son of Yahweh. Remember, John the Baptist had to point out Yahshua the Messiah. So that's where it's not only to Moses, but even beyond Moses. But what he's talking about there is talking about the dispensation of Moses. You follow? From Adam and through the dispensation of Moses, which is the fourth dispensation. Right. Read.
Even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression.
Mm-hmm. What is that? Noah, Melchizedek, Abraham, Isaac, you know, until after. Remember, all those things were going on before that law was given to the Gentiles, or to the Jews, I'm sorry, my faux pas, unto the Jews, and the Jews alone. Gentiles didn't have anything to do with that law. Although they did do by nature the things contained in the law, but it's not that law that we're talking about. Keep reading.
Who is the figure of him that was to come?
The figure, you see. The figure of shape. That's why the types and shadows are a figure. That's why this little boy here on this cross is a figure of him to come. Because he's coming, and he has come, and he has taken up residence within the sons of Yahweh in order to preach the gospel unto your salvation. You follow? This is what we're ascribing to do. And we're about to read Nebuchadnezzar about his dream and what the Spirit put in Daniel in order to interpret Nebuchadnezzar's dream. I'm just setting up a little foundation so one understands that all of this is about Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
From Adam all the way to Moses is your Old Testament, is your scriptures, is what you can know something about one Yahshua the Messiah. Because understand, Yahshua himself said, you're not going to know the Father unless you know the Son.
Right.
So you got to know the Son unless you won't know the Father. Samuel said, may Yahweh give us understanding by way of the Son. And now we have that Son out here at Golgotha in Calvary doing a particular thing. Dying, being buried, and having to resurrect. Back to Isaiah before we go to Daniel, please.
28. Precept upon precept.
Uh-huh.
Line upon line.
Okay.
Line upon line.
Now this is what we're expressing. That there's a bloodline. Okay. I'm gonna need 1 John 5 and 7 too, please. A water line and a spirit line. And you see it's down here in this lower section of this chart. Okay, known as the court roundabout. You follow? And in this middle section is the holy place. Principles and precepts that align here in this holy place that you'll be able to perceive some information about Yahweh. And then you have a most holy place line, if you would, of events that have taken place that depict a state of eternity or a state of being one with Yahweh. Okay? This is what we have to understand. We're reading Isaiah 28, 9, and 10, but we have to understand first 1 John 5 and 7, if you can start.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Now there's three, you follow, that bear record in heaven. Now, keep reading.
The Father.
Now we have it expressed as the Father.
The Word.
Expressed it as the Word.
And the Holy Spirit.
And expressed it as the Holy Spirit.
And these three are one.
Now these three are one. That's the unity of the Spirit. When it says there are three that are in heaven, what he's expressing is this. There is Yahweh, pure spirit.
Right.
That's all that there is. But you can't perceive Yahweh, pure spirit.
That's right.
Point blank. That's the one that them three are looking at, that you read, that she just read. But what we're looking at is Elohim, which is not a name, it's a title. In this state and condition would be, is in this state and condition is incorporeal. And in this physical state and condition is concrete. You follow?
Right.
These three are one. Mm-hmm. That's how, if you want to say it, there are three: pure spirit, incorporeal, and concrete. That's the three states and conditions of Yahweh. They're not separate. That's right. Not a trinity.
Right.
These are two manifestations, of the one Yahweh. You follow? Now, why it's set up like this is because of this. Read.
And there are three that bear witness on earth.
Now we're going to get three that's bearing witness on earth. And it's going to be what?
The spirit.
The spirit.
The water.
The spirit line down through the ages and dispensation. Mm-hmm. You follow? Because it's the spirit, angel is symbolic to a spirit that cast them out. You have that spirit that closed the Noah's ark. You follow? You have the spirit that stayed Abraham's hand before he killed Isaac. Right. You have that spirit that led them, the children of Israel, through the Red Sea.
Right.
That cloud by day and the fire by night. And there's an angel in the midst of that cloud.
Right.
We can read it to you. There is one there. Mm-hmm. And then you have this tabernacle here. This quickening or this oil that every high priest and low priest had to be drenched with in order to minister inside the holy place. There had to be a transition here, and that's what that quickening or that oil represents, is the spirit. You follow? Just like you have on your body, adrenal glands that sit on top of your kidney stones, right, whereby you have a fight or flight condition within yourself. That you do marvelous things, women saving their kids under grave distress, be having a burst of that energy or power or a quickening. That's what that spirit is depicting. You follow? And so we're running down through these times, and that's that spirit line. Run that next verse. Through the spirit and what?
The water.
The water, where there's a water line now. You have Yahshua Messiah being baptized in water or being immersed in water. You have this labor here in the tabernacle, whereby they washed. The high priest and the low priest washed themselves, and they also washed that sacrifice, that innocent sacrifice they washed in this labor. And then you have this Red Sea, where all the children of Israel were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. You follow? And then you have this Noah Ark, where they're going to be the thought of that flood that was coming that inspired Noah to preach for 120 years because of that flood or that inundation of flood or of water going to be coming upon all of mankind. You see, that's a principle that we're looking at through here. And we have that water that was that by the sweat on Adam's forehead and Adam's brow all the days of his life, you follow, of that working in order to work oneself up out of a decrepit state of consciousness or the thinking, you follow. That's what that immersion is, because we're immersed in a hellhole of a lot these days, right? But how are we thinking about that, and what are we sweating about to hopefully have some stability at the later days?
That's right.
Or these days that those later days were referring to, you follow. That's that water principle down through the ages and dispensations from Adam until Moses, you follow. What's that next one we got to work by?
And the blood.
Now we got a bloodline. You see, you said line upon line and precept upon precept. This is what we're looking at, this bloodline here. So we got to know all of these things before we get into Nebuchadnezzar. Because you don't know why Nebuchadnezzar's asleep unless you know there's a death. There's a principle of blood being asleep.
Right.
And so when we see that principle come down through the ages and dispensations from Adam, you follow? Because, hey, death was playing upon all of mankind, you follow, at this time. And then you have Noah. You read over there in Ezekiel talking about 33, 4, and 6, talking about the watchman, you follow? If the watchman don't preach, then the blood's going to be on his head. But lo and behold, Noah did preach for 120 years throughout the four corners of the earth, and he put the blood on the people's head. That's the principle of Noah down through the ages and dispensations. You follow? And you've got the children of Israel here. In the 12th chapter of Exodus, you can read about this Passover event. But there was blood they had to put on the top post, the two side posts, and dip it from a basin. That principle of 4 points follow the same pattern all the way down. And that's the line that we're looking at, that you can see how the principle of the Holy Spirit, which is Yahshua, mm-hmm, working down through the ages and dispensations,
right,
by this witnessing,
right,
of what they had to do. They had to put the blood here because the death angel was coming on that last plague. You know there was 10 plagues down in Egypt, right?
Right.
And those 10 plagues are your concepts and your opinions and your your imaginations. Or those are the gods or idols that the children of Israel. Remember, they were polytheistic down here in Egypt. They worshiped many gods. There's like many concepts you have, many doctrines, many denominations that there are that are down here. But they all got slayed by the by Yahweh, destroying each one of these plagues. And that last plague was the plague of the death angel unto the firstborn. There's a significant purpose for that firstborn. We don't have time for that. But we're talking about that firstborn that was going to be slayed by that death angel. You follow? And that's what this blood was for. It's to help prevent them from having their firstborn of man and beast be slayed in their houses. And we saw that. We read about that as a Passover, if you would. But this is the meaning of this. You have this tabernacle. It is a pattern after heavenly things. And this tabernacle pattern has a brazen altar of sin offerings. You follow? That they, the children of Israel, had to do. Not Gentiles, but the children of Israel. And this brazen altar of sin offering had four corners. You follow? Just like you had the four points on the door. Just like they went to the four corners of the earth. Right. These are the principles we're seeing of the blood that she just talked about. This is the line that we're talking about. Hey, lo and behold, Yahshua the Messiah, or Jesus Christ, if you want to call him that. Let me rephrase that too. People call this man who hung on the cross Jesus Christ. Right. That's what you call him. And what you don't fail to often see is that he's fulfilling that which we set up by way of this lamb back here with the children of Israel. Guess what? He was nailed in his hand, on both hands. He had nailed in his feet, and he had a crown of thorns on his head. Those are the four points of blood principle, the line that we can see that he's fulfilling, and he's set up all the way down since the fall of Adam. And when people look at this guy, Jesus Christ, on the cross, they fail to realize that this is not just Jesus. This is Yahshua the Messiah from Yahweh that dwelt in the body of Adam. And he moved all things through time. He put everything in motion. Thank you, Doc. He put everything in motion once this event took place, that he set that up, and whereby now he himself come in to fulfill and move it all out of the way. You follow? But understanding that he set it up for us now to look back at. That's why we have John, 1 John 5 and 7, expressing that there are three in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. And then they agree in the spirit, the water, and the blood. And I just went through line upon line, precept upon precept. What else is there?
And these three agree in one.
See, these events that are taking place, they're agreeing in the one Yahweh, then the one purpose, in the one spirit. And we can see, if we ran it all the way up, this is a downward descending plate. You have to understand this elementary chart and how it's set up, because they're not all up and down. This is a downward. This is a fall. You have Noah in this plate. Noah actually holds three plates, plate 18, 19, and 20, and even 21 is talking about Noah, but in an upward and downward fashion, picking up the blood, the water, the spirit in each one of them. You follow? Giving you or us witness to Yahshua, the Messiah, which is the Holy Spirit, working by way of Yahweh. It's Yahweh's purpose. That's what we say. Not Yahshua's purpose, but Yahweh's purpose. And his son is working it through it. And that's what we're seeing through these types and shadows throughout time. Anything else there, Isaiah?
No. Isaiah. Well, yeah.
28:19. Yeah.
For precept must be upon precept. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay. Here a little and there a little.
That here a little, there a little. I went from here, from Yahshua the Messiah, back to the Lamb. Hey, went to the four corners of the earth, of that death that reigned with Adam. You follow the four corners of the earth. Here a little, there a little is what we're talking about. We're talking about a little water here with the most of the children of Israel going through the Red Sea. And you see, First Corinthians, the 10th chapter, talks about this flood here. But keep reading.
For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people.
See, I'm speaking to the people stuttering and bumbling through this, trying to recall and to bring your attentions to these principle lines. You follow? Not always beautiful, but the point is, if you can see through the stuttering and the mumbling, just as Moses was a stutterer and a mumbler, he put something in him whereby his brother Aaron was able to come down and be his spokeshole for him in order to deliver the information that Yahweh needed his people to know. And I'm not doing anything different than what was being expressed in through a vessel, through a body of this which we have received. You follow? Keep reading Isaiah.
To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest.
Oh, this is the rest. May cause the weary to rest. This I'm going to need Matthew 11 down to the bottom, that yoke.
Yeah.
You got Isaiah. Isaiah is saying, this is the rest. Line upon line, precept upon precept, right? Right. It's going to cause, not set free, but cause or make the weary to rest. What is that? Line upon line. The blood, the water, the spirit, the principle of this Holy Spirit moving throughout the ages and dispensations throughout time. Whereby we're going to learn through physical things that's going to point to spiritual things. That's Romans 1:19 and 20. We're going to catch that, right? But now look who else says about being giving you rest. You have it?
Matthew 11:28.
Let's talk about it.
Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden.
Oh, come unto me, Yahshua the Messiah, which is the Holy Spirit, read.
And I will give you rest.
I will give you rest. Just as Isaiah said, the blood, the water, the spirit, it's going to give you the rest in the knowledge of what the precept upon precept is, what the line upon line is. This knowledge is going to give you rest as to why Adam, why Noah, why Abraham, why the children of Israel, why this tabernacle pattern. Everything. That's going to give you the rest Isaiah was talking about. But see, you got Yahshua down here fulfilling that statement of Isaiah, because Isaiah didn't write that in and of his own. It was his Holy Spirit. It was him that wrote that to Isaiah 28, 9, and 10 about the law and the prophets. You follow? Keep reading.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
You take that yoke. This yoke has been on him this whole time, trying to kill the spirit. Then you don't think they was? They had Pharaoh down here early on with Moses, trying to kill and catch that spirit. Mm-hmm. You follow? There was a death decree when Moses was being born. Every child, 2 and under. They were trying to kill that death decree because why? It was going to be coming too many Israelites. Trying to kill that spirit. But you see, that spirit just ducked and dodged and moved right around. And what? Moses' mother put him in that ark of the bulrushes, buried him. See, that death decree, that's your death principle that we just went across.
Right.
That death principle that Pharaoh had set out amongst the children of Israel, that's your death. And then she buried him and put him in what? Water. That's your water principle.
Right.
And then what? A few days later, at a point in time, Pharaoh's daughter comes down and resurrects him up. That's the spirit resurrecting him up out of that death-like state. And then what? He ended up tearing with Pharaoh and his household for some 40 years. That's a resurrection. That's your 40 principle in this plate. These are principles we're running now, and we're going to catch it because, hey, he's going to kill a man again. Kill him. That's your death principle. And then what? He's going to bury him in the sand, and then he's going to resurrect out into Midian, right? Now he's coming back out here to the Midian, tending to his father-in-law's flock. That's a type and a shadow of Yahshua coming in and taking care of his flock. You follow? When he came in and he's fulfilling. That's a fulfillment of Moses. Why Moses go out here into Jethro's land? You follow? Mm-hmm. To tend to his flock. It's a type and shadow. He's out here for 40 years, and then he comes to this burning bush. You see, and then here is where we get that story, and we understand that at this burning bush, he receives a name that they did not have from Adam all the way down until Moses. They did not have the name of Yahweh. They only knew, they being Noah and Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they only knew that spirit as El Shaddai, or in other words, the Almighty Provider. You follow? Now the Almighty Provider is no longer that. He's a Savior. Yahshua the Messiah is the Savior that we're seeing now. The conditions, the time has changed, you see? Right. And now we're ushered into an understanding about Yahshua. Anything there in Matthew else?
For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls.
Until your souls. See, Biden and them not talking about your souls. You follow? The laws and the things that we see that we want to put in place is not about your souls. No law is going to give you rest besides the law of the Spirit. And this is where we've come to let you know that that's the only thing operating anything. Because no government anywhere is going to roll out anything that's pertaining to a soul. They don't know nothing about a soul.
Yeah.
You follow? Because Yahshua is here telling us that come unto him. And you can't go to him physically anywhere. Because he is spirit. He is the Holy Spirit. And this teaching brings you unto an awareness about what was done in the Old Testament. Because that New Testament is a biography about Yahshua the Messiah. That's what people fail to realize. They're telling you, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is expressing to you what they experienced while with Yahshua the Messiah. You see? And now after his death, burial, and resurrection, as it were, coming up out of that grave, after having went back. He, remember, Yahshua went back and preached to the captives of hell in order to redeem them, right? That's part of that body that we're going to be made up of in order to take off this physical flesh. That's coming up through the universal revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. But it's not yet quite finished because we're still pressing forward in the gospel, in the preaching of the gospel, so that whomever needs to yet hear these words, right, will come into that right body of Yahshua the Messiah. Come into that rest of knowing who Yahshua is. That's what we're delving to seek and to express to people, right, whereby after this outpouring of the Holy Spirit, that it entered into the hearts and minds of men. This knowledge, this gospel, keep reading. Mm-hmm. There.
For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
12. Yeah.
That's good. It goes into 12. But this is the spirit of the blood, the water, and the spirit that's going to give you rest in understanding anything about one Yahshua Messiah. You follow? And so we're endeavoring to know something about this spirit. Let's go back to Daniel. We'll catch a little bit in Daniel, and I'll leave it at that. And hold your place with 1 Corinthians 15 chapter, but get Daniel first.
Okay.
Just finish up Daniel.
1 Corinthians. Okay, with Daniel's. Where was I? Okay. 6.
Okay.
But if you show the dream and the interpretation of ye shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream.
See, that's what the government do. They give you gifts and give you things. Like Nebuchadnezzar is going to give you something. He's going to they're selective in who they give things and who they don't give things to. That's the nature of mankind. That's what Nebuchadnezzar is depicting, is the nature of that mankind. But keep reading.
They answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation of it. The king answered and said, I know of a certainty that ye will gain the time, because ye see the thing is gone from me. But if ye will not make known unto me the dream, there is but one decree for you. For ye have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me,
mm-hmm,
till the time be changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that ye can show me the interpretation thereof.
That means he don't understand the mystery. This mystery by which we're going over and going through to bring one's attention to the blood, the water, the spirit. These are the mystery that Nebuchadnezzar don't know nothing about. He wasn't time for him to know anything about. Keep reading.
The Chaldeans answered before the king and said, this is not a man upon the earth that can show the king's matter.
Man, ain't nobody can do that. Come on, man. Come on, Neb. Why you put that on us? And telling us that you surely know the end. If you can't do it, it's death.
Yeah.
Read.
Therefore, there is no king, prince, nor ruler that asks such thing at any magician or astrologer or Chaldean.
Nobody. That's why I said, you celebrate all you want. There ain't nobody's going to bring your soul unto Yahshua the Messiah. There's nothing they can do. Reading the dreams, because you don't understand according to the mystery that's been before the world ever began. And this is what we're expressing. And Daniel is going to come and tell him about that. Keep reading.
And it is a rare thing that the king requires, and there is none other that can show it before the king, except the Elohim, whose dwelling is not with flesh.
Oh, that except the Elohim that's not dwelling with the flesh. That's why they know that there is a spirit. That's why they give prayer. That's why they try to be nice. That's why they try to follow this law, ignorantly so. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to let them know that the Elohim, that they also are aware of, as I said, they know about Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, but they don't know how that works. Mm-hmm. But that Elohim, read.
For this cause, the king was angry and very furious and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain.
That don't seem so fair. That don't seem fair. It's not fair that the world is able to go do all the mischief that it does. But that's Yahweh's purpose doing that.
Right.
Just as Yahweh had this situation under full control. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
And they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain.
Mm-hmm.
Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch,
mm-hmm.
the captain of the king's guard.
Hey, before you get, they were already set up to go to jail. Read.
Captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
And he answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain.
They've been captivated out of Judah, I believe. And this is now they had them already quarantined of the wise men of Israel. Keep reading.
Why is the decree so hasty from the king?
Yeah.
Then Arioch made the thing known to Daniel.
Mm-hmm.
Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time and that he would show the king the interpretation.
Yahweh, Daniel having the Holy Spirit in Daniel of Elohim is going to say, hey, make some time for me and the king. And let me express some things to him of the Elohim. Read.
Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah and Michael and Azariah, his companion, that they would desire mercy of the Elohim of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision.
Because you understand here at this point, Daniel and his boys, they were the elect of Israel, and they came under Nebuchadnezzar's court, and they were wise men and prophets at that time with Nebuchadnezzar. And yet, when Daniel heard that they're going to kill all the wise men, he said, hey, wait, hold up. Yeah. What's the story? Just talk about this, Neb. Mm-hmm. And this is what Daniel has expressed, and he went and spoke to the Elohim. You follow? Read.
Then Daniel blessed the Elohim of heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of Elohim forever and ever.
Blessed be the name of the Elohim forever and ever. See, when we read that, they think the Elohim is a name. That's short for Elohim. That's a singular person because Elohim is pluralistic. Mm-hmm. The Elohim is singular, you see, but it's still a title. But he's talking to Yahweh Elohim. Abraham knew this Eloah as El Shaddai. That's why that El runs down through Michael, Gabriel. Right. You follow? That El is depictive, and they know that's a title because it's the descriptive word. Hey, Daniel hadn't known. Read.
For wisdom and might are his.
Mm-hmm.
And he changeth the time and the season, and he removeth kings and sitteth of kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding.
Mm-hmm.
He revealeth deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with them.
See, the Eloah knows that. Daniel don't know that.
Right.
That's the spirit I'm expressing, that's what Daniel's writing, but Daniel didn't know it. Keep reading.
I thank thee and praise thee, O thou Eloah of my fathers,
mm-hmm.
who has given me wisdom and might, and has made known unto me now what we desire of thee.
Mm-hmm.
For thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore Daniel went in unto Arioch, whom the king had ordained to destroy the wise men mm-hmm. of Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
He went and said thus unto him, destroy not the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show unto the king the interpretation.
See, Daniel didn't know. It's that spirit. And that's that same spirit that's running down through the ages and dispensations in order that they might get caught up to understand these things, right? Mm-hmm. What verse you on?
25.
Okay.
Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king.
Daniel 1 and 25? Where we at?
225.
225, right. Yeah. All right.
Brought in Daniel before the king in haste and said thus unto him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah that will make known unto the king the interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
The king answered and said unto Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, art thou able to make known unto me the mm-hmm. dream which mm-hmm. I have seen and the interpretation thereof?
That's what Nebuchadnezzar is telling them. We're following the conversation now, read.
Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said,
mm-hmm.
the secret which the king has demanded cannot the wise men, the astrologers, and the magicians, soothsayers, show unto the king.
See, Daniel said, can't nobody, and that's why I said, can't no nation, under whatever rule and regulation you put in power, president from king on earth, is not going to be able to bring you unto your salvation and of what Yahweh has laid for the sons of Yahweh. Yeah, in the world, but not of the world, you follow? That whatever you holiday you want to bring up in whatever nation around the globe ain't going to do you a diddly squat.
That's right.
Because it's all destined for the lake. But keep reading mm-hmm. what Daniel say.
But there is the Eloah mm-hmm. in heaven mm-hmm. that reveal its secrets.
That's right.
And make it known to the king Nebuchadnezzar uh-huh. what shall be in the latter days.
Mm-hmm.
The dream.
In the latter days, you follow? We're in those latter days, but that's another story. Uh-huh. Keep reading.
Thy dreams and the visions of thy head upon thy bed are these.
Mm-hmm.
As for thee, O king.
See, when he was dead, and he was immersed in the dream, but he wasn't able to be resurrected because he went about to kill everybody again.
Yeah.
See, this is a resurrection, or the spirit telling Daniel, telling Nebuchadnezzar about his state and condition, mm-hmm. and telling us now of Yahweh instituting through Daniel this event.
Right.
That Daniel was pulling out of what Moses said. Having to understand that they were down here with a king called Pharaoh. You follow? And Pharaoh was having conversations, but we have to remember that who hardened Pharaoh's heart? Was it not Yahweh?
That's right.
Yeah, being Yahweh, hey, hardened Nebuchadnezzar's mental state, pulled Nebuchadnezzar out of this immersed state, and he had to go get Daniel from the Eloah that told Daniel about this vision, and he's about to run it down to him right now. Read.
As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind mm-hmm. upon thy bed.
Uh-huh.
What should come to pass hereafter?
Uh-huh.
And he that revealed his secret make it known to thee what shall come to pass.
Read.
But as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have.
See, not even Daniel had the wisdom. He's not a great major prophet. He's not a minor. He's just a vessel being used by Elohim in order to write these things. Right. Read.
more than any living, mm-hmm. but for their sake that shall make known the interpretation.
See, for their sake that shall be made known. For our sake, after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, now that we have the whole story, we're going to be able to go back and show you from Adam all the way until the dispensation of Moses about these things that you're seeing, Nebuchadnezzar. Because it's not about the children of Israel or the people at that time. It's for us. He just said it. He just said it. For those, we at a later time. And I said it. We ain't got time to go into the later time. But he's saying those now after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which was on the day of Pentecost, right? Some 50 days after Yahshua Messiah resurrected, he filled the hearts and minds of men, whereby now they're going to have the gospel in order to preach, in order to resurrect a man into the yoke of Yahshua the Messiah, whereby he's going to give us rest and peace,
right.
You know, in the Holy Spirit. That's all he was. And Daniel's running it down to Nebuchadnezzar. This is why you're having the dream, my man. It ain't for you. It ain't for me.
Right.
It's for those. After, at an appointed time, is going to be able to preach that which the Messiah has set up. Keep reading.
For their sake that shall make known the interpretation to the king,
uh-huh.
and that thou mightest know the thoughts of thy heart.
Uh-huh.
Thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image.
Mm-hmm.
This great image, whose brightness was excellent,
mm-hmm.
stood before thee,
mm-hmm.
and the form thereof was terrible.
Mm-hmm.
This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass,
mm-hmm.
his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and break them to pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floor. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth.
Mm-hmm. See, that whole image is Daniel talking about the history, the whole earth. And that stone is Yahshua, the Messiah.
Right.
But keep, what verse you at?
36.
Mm. Okay.
Are we close?
Yeah.
Okay. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king.
Okay. So now he just told Nebuchadnezzar the dream. That's what he saw. He didn't know or understand what that stone was. He didn't understand what this image was, right? We got a little bit of time. Let's catch it. A few verses. You can read this on your own. The rest of the story is very linear. It's very direct and to the point. But read the first few verses, and then we're going to skip to 11 a little bit, or to 3.
3?
No, keep reading where you're at.
Oh, okay. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the Lord of heaven has given thee a kingdom, power and strength and glory, and wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven has he given into thy hand, and has made thee ruler over them all. Thou art this head of gold, and after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth, and the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these, shall it break in pieces now, and bruise.
So Daniel just runs down Babylon, Medes and Persians, Greeks. He just runs that whole image down that we have depicted here, right? And he's going to express those things. Let's skip on down to 46 or 45.
45.
Mm-hmm.
For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of uh-huh. the mountain without hands,
uh-huh.
and that it break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold.
See, he broke up all this. This is he broke the clay, his toes, the iron, which is Rome and papal Rome, the brass, which is Grecia, the silver, the Medes and Persia, and the gold of Babylon. That's where they at right now. Keep reading.
The great Lord has made known to the king mm-hmm. what shall come to pass mm-hmm. hereafter.
That's when he letting them know. Read.
And the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof, sure.
That's sure enough. That's the one sure gospel that's going to be able to redeem your soul unto salvation. You follow? That stone, which is the Eloah, or Yahshua, the Messiah. Right. Read the next verse, please.
Then the king Nebuchadnezzar fell upon his face.
He fell upon his face, you follow? He had the resurrection. He was dead. He was buried in the dream, and he just got the interpretation, and he had to bow down. Read.
And worshiped Daniel and commanded that they should offer an oblation and sweet odor unto him.
Uh-huh.
The king answered unto Daniel and said, of a truth it is, mm-hmm. that your Lord is the Elohim and sovereign of kings and a revealer of secrets, seeing thou couldest reveal this secret.
That's out of the mouth of Nebuchadnezzar. You can read the rest of that. It'll be made clear. But they will, all shall bow to the glory and mighty of one Yahshua the Messiah by way of Yahweh our Elohim. Mm-hmm. If you got anything out of today's class, all praises and honor to our beloved Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. End of our Sunday class, and we thank you for attending. We have, I got the information for Dr. Nathan Higgins' funeral, and he's entrusted to the Kinley Funeral Home, and cards and condolences can be sent to the family, which is his daughter. And that's Mrs. Denise Higgins Thomas. And we have the address that's in Springfield, Ohio, 248 Raffensperger, Raffensperger Avenue, Springfield, Ohio, 45505. And if anybody out there that needs to know the information can contact us through email. So I hope everyone has enjoyed classes this morning. And with that being all the announcement, would everyone stand to be dismissed with the doxology? Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before and now. Let us all say,